we move on to the next session, the critical appraisal of journal article by Professor Kotur, Dean AVMC. Professor Kotur is presently Dean at AVMC. He has worked as Vice Chancellor of Sri Devaraj URS University, Kolar, Karnataka. And he has held various positions in anesthesia professional bodies. He has been Executive Committee Member of WFSA, President Indian Society of Anesthesiologists, Editor Indian Journal of Anesthesia, Editor SAARC Journal of Anesthesia, and Member Executive Council SAARC Association of Anesthesiologists. He has delivered more than 40 guest lectures, orations at various national and international conferences, and has more than 75 scientific publications. And sir has been instrumental in establishing departments of medical education, health professions education, and skill and simulation labs in all the three universities where he had worked. Sir, we'd like to hear from you, sir. Welcome you.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Vidyavati, my colleagues, Professor Bhatt, Mahalakshmi, and other colleagues. Satyamurthy is there. And of course, Dr. Amol. Indeed,
not there today.
Happy to share some thoughts on this topic of critical appraisal, which is done by everybody in the profession at different levels. As a student, I have done. As a teacher, I have done. As an administrator, I have to do. That's very important. And now the 60 minutes that has been allotted to me, what I have tried to divide it is, about 30 minutes. From 30 minutes, I will share some thoughts. And of course, you all understand there are handicaps. This will be able to be a physical session. We would have had it, very interactions and make it more lively. We have some handicaps, and because of that, we have modified suitably. And the remaining part of this kind of a open session, rather it should have been a group activity, which will consume time. It will not be possible to conduct it. And one article I hope I have circulated to all the participants. And I assume, in every session, whenever, wherever I'm conducting, I ask, resource material was sent to you. How many of you have gone through it? Raise your hands. None of the hands, one or two half-hearted hands. Then we used to give some time for them to read there only from 15 minutes, 20 minutes like that. Now we don't have time for that. I assume that, at least 10% of the people would have read it. And yesterday I asked Mahalakshmi how to sort it out. We have found out a novel solution. We have identified some people and we'll elicit interactions with them. Morning, Dr. Vidyavati was also asking, whom, sir, who all should then? I said, you only decide.
Sir, we can do anyway. One now also, sir. We can ask people who have read the article to put number one in the chat box, and people who have not read the article can put number two in the chat box. So you will get an idea. One for read the article, two for not read the article.
You want to give some time for that, a minute?
1 minute. Oh.
Yes.
I have.
Already I got three.
Yeah.
Manju has read, Gomati has read. Good, great. Oh my God, good. Jayita has read, okay. Yeah.
Dr. Uma Devi.
No?
Yeah. Dr. C.B. Mandela, Rakesh, Sasmita. Dr. Sudha Patli.
Until 1-2 comes, we'll wait.
Okay.
That means we'll assume Rajan. Rajan has read. Because in fact, he only gave me yesterday late evening that article.
No, not that Dr. Rajan, sir. BSALP, Dr. Rajan.
Okay, good.
Okay, sir.
Good. So at least, I said that the total number of participants are 145, at least about say 10% I was expecting. Okay, nearing to that, it's a good, excellent. We'll go to the business. I will share the screen now. One sec. Sorry, Vidyavati, is it visible?
Sir, yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, yeah. Make it full screen, sir.
Ah, yeah, 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 yeah. I'm making.
Ah, yes, sir. Visible. Yeah.
I already said how I will have divided the time. Now the time is 3:09. My count starts from now, so that I will not be accelerating halfway through. You know, already time is over or something. So I'll try to answer some basic questions: what, why, how of critical appraisal. Many of you might already be knowing it, and I will have some thoughts on how exactly critical appraisal has to be there, and what are the tools available for that. And we have a couple of checklists. Of course, with the permissions, Google downloaded from the Google. And because I overheard somebody asking questions to Dr. Amol, previous speaker, you know, these questionnaires, etc. Can we use it? So some require, some are free, like that. And I have some thoughts on fast track appraisal, which is also very much needed. You can't go on telling that I am doing a critical appraisal. I will take one day. I will take 1 hour. That kind of a thing. Now everything is fast, and we have a last 30 minutes group activity of that, or some open session. So I try to define in the simplest possible way. Many of you might be aware of the definition. It is an looking at the published research or public literature in an objective and a structured way, systematic way, in order to find how authentic it is, how nearer to the truth it is. If you go by the definition of the dictionary definition of the critical, you know, critical is something you are inclined to find fault, you know, something when you are reading. That's what the dictionary meaning says. And of course, appraisal is like valuing it or estimating the value of it. So it is self-explanatory, the term critical appraisal, judging the or assessing the value of something which has been published. So in this exercise, you'll be finding out the strengths and the weaknesses. No doubt you are trying to find out the faults, but at the same time, you should have a wisdom to appreciate the strengths in that, which will certainly be of help to anybody, whoever is doing the critical appraisal. Now, the issue is who has to do the critical appraisal? The answer is anybody. I said, last four, they all, teacher, student, professional, and everybody other than these three also. And this is the table I made here, you know, why everybody does, the student does the critical appraisal, why the teacher does, why the clinician they do, and any other professionals. So student will be, you know, doing that in the learning phase of how to do critical appraisal, especially the postgraduates. It's one of the important modes of instructions of the postgraduate curriculum, every weekly journal clubs. Yes, and it is one of the very important component of the PG dissertation as well, you know, big review of literature section will be there. You need to have appraise it. You need to appraise that and write the inference out of that. And the teacher will be to teach critical appraisal. And if the teacher is very passionate about the preaching evidence-based education, now certainly he will have to do the critical appraisal of the educational research. And of course, clinicians, you know, this is the era of evidence-based medicine. Anybody wants to give optimal care to the patient, best available care in the to the patient available anywhere in the world, and also the clinical decision making has to be correct. Now with the consumer redressal forum and all, you know, you are exposed to so many things, wanted and unwanted. So optimal clinical decision making also has to be there. As a part of that, the clinician has to do the critical appraisal. And of course, for doing the research, that is the mainstay of doing any research, like appraisal of the existing literature. Are there any other purpose, any other professional, or professionals belonging to other, like a management person? So he wants to do evidence-based management, public health person, he wants to do evidence-based public health, like that. So whoever is supposed to do with a specific purpose in the mind is what we want to do with that. Now we'll try to answer the question, why critical appraisal? The voluminous data that is published, you know, I always say if anybody try to read, if you start reading every day, 24 hours a day, all the articles that are published across the globe in a subject, if you start reading today, no time for food, sleep, anything, then at the end of 1 year, you will lag behind by 2 years. That will give an overall idea how much of literature is pouring out. These are all the numbers, you know, 6 million articles are published every day. On an average, every journal publishes 70 articles per day. There are about 5,000 journals, 6,000 journals. Those kind of statistics are available. The last point, the one thing is, the average quality score of RCTs published in these reputed internationally time-tested journals, less than 50% score. You know, that means we always call it as a Kigo technology, you know, garbage in and garbage comes out, you know. So that you have to keep that thing in mind. That will lay down the need for appraisal of the literature that is published. And this is a very important statement. Reader must take the personal responsibility for judging the validity and clinical importance of the medical. Whoever publishes it, suppose anybody reads it, it is his responsibility to judge it, give a value to it. He can't say that he has published it, so I have followed and I gave it to my patient and the patient kicked the bucket. So no, the author is not responsible. So you have to be, like, you know, the law of communication. If the communicatee doesn't understand what the communicator is telling, the fault lies with the communicator. Similar principle here. So the person who reads, not the author, must take the responsibility for applying the findings of the research to his patients or his setup. So this is another aspect of critical appraisal. The physicians now, especially COVID period, has taught us quite a lot, many new lessons, like, you know, the media, misleading the public literature, etc. And public is, you know, inundated with medical advice and what to follow, what not to follow. Okay. So the task of the damage control to the public or community, that lies with the physician, that lies with the medical professionals. You should tell, be able to educate, tell the people what is right, what is wrong. Somebody advertising, you know, with good, some other faiths, you know, damage control. You remember one South American country, they started COVID drink free to all college, compulsory to the college schools. So that was all quite misleading. Sometimes even we know about the controversy about the chloroquines. So these kind of things, our physician's duty is to educate the public as what is, that is the task of damage control. There are some general rules for what forming the journal club. We all normally say when we do the postgraduate journal clubs, circulate the articles at least 15 days before. Though not the full article, circulate the tech summary. Then the presenter has to be ready to answer all the queries of the participants by checking all the cross references, and he should have sufficient information to answer the queries put forth by the participants. And many a times we have seen, I remember, you know, the journal clubs. Now, the lot many changes have happened. Earlier, I remember 80s and all, you know, journal club. While coming to the journal club only, I remember there was not even a postgraduate department. We had one senior member. While coming to the journal club, he used to come via library and get any one journal which he picks up. Journal should be lucky enough for him, from him to be picked up. And he used to open it and read from beginning to end. That used to happen. Now, those things with awareness and education reforms, etc., those things are not happening. But anyway, that is not to be. And generally, you know, our law of anyway, how much time one person can listen to other, you apply that in 45 minutes to maximum 1 hour, everything, including presentation, and including the interaction, everything should be over. Now, I always take help of this article written by George Bordas from University of Illinois, a medical educationist and a physician intensivist. Internist, not an intensivist. And this article was published almost 32 years back now, yes. And this is used across the many journals, I know, many places, you know. It is a wonderful document wherein the critical appraiser, you can use it to read an article, you can use it to write an article, and the marks have been allotted to that. And when I was editing the National Journal 7 years, you know, I used to use it for even peer reviewing or editorial scrutiny. I used to that. And wonderful, you know, you will not miss anything. This is what is. I just scan through that, and that is available on the net also. You can download that. And I just scan through that, and wherever possible, I'll stress on some points so that I'll keep up my time. So about the title, you know, all of us know, title should be crisp, brisk, clear, not misleading. You can't give a very attractive title, you know, sudden complication, these kind of things, you know, is not educated. Primary objective of the article should be of the study has to be reflected. This is what you see. And keywords from the medical subject heading words. Yesterday, Pushpa was taking that review in the literature and review of literature. In that one, a lot of emphasis on this medical subject heading words, which is there on the right hand side of the homepage of PubMed. And your keywords are chosen from that YouTube track. So just try to have that. And this is one general statement, might be wrong. Reputed authors from a reputed place increase the authenticity. There might be exceptions, right? So that's why you check for the credentials of the authors, affiliations, address, etc. So now coming to the word component abstract. Abstract is either of the structured or unstructured, wherein the embedded structure is used to display the abstract. That is a structured word. Unstructured is in the paragraph. And you know, just go through that, and whether it's, you have to have some fair idea, because that is the one which will abstract, is the one which converts onlooker into a reader. So it should be gone like that, whether it is written or not properly. Now coming to the introduction, this is a very important thing. Necessarily, introduction will be about 1, 2, 3 or maximum 4 paragraphs. It certainly doesn't run in pages. One. And if, to be specific, it will necessarily contain 3 paragraphs. What is known about the topic? What is not known about your topic? Deduct what is not known from the known, then you will get the need. Whether the author has justified the need for the study or not is the one which you see when you read an article with the intention of doing critical appraisal. If the need is not justified, then the whole purpose is useless. So the pertinence or need has to be said. And overall, introduction gives you an overall big picture of what is going to be there inside. And generally, you see the last paragraph of the introduction. Hence, we have attempted to do this. Hence, this study, these kind of wordings, you see that. And a word about the citations. The introduction is not the one where you have all 30, 40, 50 citations to be listed there, you know, maximum 3 to 5. Citations or references have to be there, what is known, what is not known, or some limitation. So that's one. These things you see. So overall conceptual framework or theoretical framework of the article, you will come to know when you read the introduction and some related review of the topic. This I already said. So I use the word funnel. So from what is known, which is very big, then what is not known becomes small, and you funnel down, narrow down to need. This is what you should keep always in mind and see whether the author has done it or not. Now coming to the material methods. So these numbers on the left hand side, 14, 15, there are total 39 parameters, what Dr. Bodar has described. And each one component has got a point marks, you know, maybe a fraction of a one also are there, and it will give a very good result, you know, if you start doing that. So then this material method should contain description, appropriate of various variables, research design, confounders, the study setting. So it should contain so much of information, detail sufficient, not more, not less, by reading which a person with average intellect should be able to reproduce the results or repeat the study. This is in a very simplified way. I'm telling how much information should material method contain. That much, not more sufficient to produce the results. And of course, you know, you are all familiar with the errors can creep into the study at any time of the study, conduct of the study, conceiving, writing, that kind of a thing. So generally, when you are doing the critical appraisal, you are well versed with the methods. Those are utilized by any researcher or a writer. Exhaust, randomization, blinding, placebo, or accounting for all the enrolled subjects. So these things, whether they have been there or not. And the results, of course, you know, efficient use. Efficient, what I mean is to display the same thing, you use a table, you use a bar diagram, that's what we see many a time. So efficient use, no repetition, which is good for that appropriate things you have to be there. And the result should be very precise. And in a word of, now we are halfway through this session, and almost all sessions, but for the statistical issues and the ethical issues, are complete in this research methodology workshop now. You're all familiar with study designs, you know, robot research, digital literature set, hypothesis, null hypothesis, all those things are there. So you are well informed about all these things. That will make the things quite quite simpler for you to do or understand the critical appraisal. So in the discussion, the essential things will be like, you know, all the debatable aspects. This is a place where the author has got some scope to express, not his personal ideas, but to express something related to what he has inferred based on the experiment he has performed. And compare, contrast with justification with other workers on the same subject. On the same subject, some other person also has done the study, right? Whether your results concur with that or not, with him or not. If yes, give the reasons. If no, try to find out the reason and justify. Oh, our results did not match with the study done by somebody else. He had a prolonged duration, whereas we had a shorter duration. I'm trying to give an example. You have to find out, justify what could possibly have been for them to get a longer duration of something, you know, what you're doing. So these kind of discussions you have to have and in the discussion. And the conclusions should always be coherent or commensurate with the design instrument. And see, many a times we'll see the primary objective, secondary objective are different. Conclusions drawn will be something generalized conclusions. Doing the study on pediatrics and concluding on the adult population. These kind of things I have seen. I've seen in the dissertations. I've seen in the articles submitted for the publications also I've seen. So you have to keep these things in mind. Now, in the discussion, two important points I said. Are the conclusions rational based on the results of the study? That's one. And second thing is, you know, in the light of the other people's findings, the results of yours have been compared and contrasted. So you specifically look for these things in the various sections. So you are doing the appraisal in a systematic way, judging in a systematic way to find out the fault or to find out the strength in each of the sections. So then the whatever you have inferred, you have to explain, that's okay. And this is a place wherein you should be honest enough to express your limitations. So probably limitations of the study. What made you not to do some things which though are important and relevant? Okay. Then hope for the future research. You know, the research builds knowledge, new knowledge. Now knowledge goes on expanding. Then somebody later on, they will do the literature search and finds that whatever is the gap, what which you think you have not addressed. So that will be the scope for the future, what you call thrust areas or something, you know, you find out the gaps, knowledge gaps. So these things have to be necessarily addressed in discussion, whether the author has done them or not. Now, this is a very important thing, references. One thing what I've seen, many of the authors, what they say is, if the more number of references are there, more authentic, more valid the study is wrong. This notion is totally wrong. So there are, even though they have no hard and fast rules and how many numbers of references have to be there for a review, for a case case report or for any clinical original article like that, there is some consensus. They say for a case report 10 to 15. And you know, for this clinical investigation, 25, for review, 45 to 60. That is just understanding. Otherwise, and many times, you know, to in order thinking that, you know, more of a validity, go on putting, make one silly statement, sun rises in the east, references 1 to 10. You know, what nonsense? You know, these kind of things also we see. So, you just whether you see and whether the standard rules for publications are there or not. And we all know that various styles of writing references, ASA style, Oxford style, Vancouver style, Harvard style, these are the two ones which are used exclusively. And which one the author has used. Of course, the referencing style will be as per the guidelines of the journal. So the journal only in the guidelines to the contributors, they will be telling, we follow this method of referencing. So that also see, and the question is, I already discussed, are they adequate? There are some general considerations whether we read IMRAD structure, introduction, methodology, results and discussion, even though they are, we try to say that they are different sections, they are not different compartments, you have to keep in mind. So transition from one to the other section has to be smooth. It has to be in the form of a narration, whether author has done it or not. Otherwise, you will lose the touch and the person will not be able to complete the article, read the complete article. And uniform, consistent terminology throughout, you know, especially we always say, non-English mother tongue authors. Start in the present tense, go to future, come back to past. These kind of things we have seen when you start editing that one. Or inch becomes centimeter, centimeter becomes meter later. Millimeters become tor. So these kind of things, ML, CC, so many things we have seen. So these are the things which will enhance the validity from different angles. The silly mistakes will bring down the value, even though a lot of stuff is there. And the tone, you know, there is no scope for any flowery language, you know, poetic language. And to all know, from the grammatical point of view, past participle passive voice has to be used. There is no scope for using active voice. I did it. We did it like that. You know, that is not the language that is accepted. I'm not telling it is wrong. That is not accepted. Past participle passive voice because the study is already over. So spelling error, grammar, so on. Of course, these things with many facilitations on the net are reduced. And when you do the critical appraisal at the end, what are the, suppose you have given a chance to give some suggestions to the authors. If you as a reader or a person who is doing a critical appraisal are able to give one or two suggestions, that shows that you have critically appraised that. And an application of your results to your setting. That is an important thing. Now, coming to the third part of our my talk, I think I have another 8-9 minutes. This is a checklist in a very simplified one. As an article as a whole, not as a different compartments, you should have, you know, whole you are totally assessing or evaluating or judging the article, not a particular section of it. So let's see, is it an original work? You should be able to answer that some positivity. Is it scientifically reliable and valid? Enough has already been talked about reliability, validity. These are the psychometric qualities of these tools. And is it clinically important or relevant or not? You know, especially in the clinical study. Relevant, what I mean is, suppose you are doing something related to COVID now, it's quite relevant. Something disease which is epidemic, which is prevalent in this particular region. So that's what decides that. And what are the strong points that I already said? What are the weaknesses? And when you say weaknesses, given a chance, do you think you are able to rectify them? Or can it be rectified? If so, how? If you say yes, yes, you should be able to say that. Before pointing out at somebody, you should know what should be the correct one. So then, you know, you have to say, is it suitable to look at them? You know, this is some checkbook, checklist, which you can apply when you are ready to present this one, what they call critical appraisal of an article. And again, you know, some more reinforcements on this, some simple questions, abstract and title should say what it is all about. Authors, what are their credentials? Introduction should necessarily answer the question, why did they do it? Why did they start it? Need for the study, yes. Material method, what was done? And what in the results, what was found? And what was found, what does it mean, is the discussion. Then the references for the framework and implications are, what is relevant to you? General consideration, style of the article, I already shared some thoughts on that. So apply these simple checklists when you do the critical appraisal. You will be doing justice for the exercise. Now, one or two thoughts about fast track appraisal. Now, everything is fast track. You know, surgery is fast track, recovery is fast track, heart surgery is fast track. So all kinds of things. Why not this critical appraisal fast track? Here again, I come back to my favorite subject, you know, evidence-based medicine. Patient has come to your counter. You want to give a updated evidence-based treatment, evidence-based advice to the patient. And If you say that, you know, I'm doing the appraisal and to find out the best evidence come tomorrow, nobody will come to you next day. So you should have a tool to assess or to do the critical appraisal first time. If you do it by practice, in my personal experience, you should be able to do it in a couple of minutes, you know, some 5-10 minutes or something. You should be able to overall give some good evidence-based, updated advice or a better decision. That's why I shared on 2 or 3 slides as how to do a critical appraisal. At a Bordage table, you go on answering one by one questions 39. Even if you take 1 minute, it will become 39 minutes. Nobody has got a time. So you should have some shortcut or a fast track appraisal of an article. Yesterday, we were about to leave office, then we decided that, you know, some article has to be circulated to all our participants. Then, you know, I was searching something, I had searched something, and Mahalakshmi came and said, no, sir, don't give any anesthesia article. I had already done that. Then I thought her advice was right. Then immediately Rajan was there, then he opened his mobile and he gave something related to COVID. I just did a fast track appraisal in 5 minutes, 10 minutes there only. Then immediately we decided, chalo, this article will be the very good one for tomorrow. So this is a 3-step process, fast track appraisal. First step is to initial validity and relevance, which is the article is relevant to the situation or not. This is the other, the macro validity, author's credibility, institutional credibility, where is one conducted, they will give initial validity and relevance. When you do that, try to find out in the second step why the article has been written or why the study has been done. Intent. Next is very simple, you validity based intent. So if you do this, you will certainly not make any mistake, gross mistake, I'll say. So to find out whether the article deserves the time to review or depth, I think questions, you know, is it from a peer-reviewed journal? Dr. Bhatt insists, and always peer-reviewed journal, Copernicus is also gone. Only Scopus or PubMed. So if it is from these credible databases where the article or a journal is enlisted, then it will increase the credibility. So is the environment of the study similar to mine? Now just see that. And is the one thing, very important thing, when the study is sponsored, we all know the reason. So everything is commercialized. So even the research is commercialized. Even the results are commercialized. See, we see so many things, even this COVID pandemic only, so many evidence came, with article published in great journals, it retracted, study was identified as fake. So many things came. So you have to be very careful when you are doing critical appraisal. If the article is from a commercial backdrop, you know, a conflict of interest, the study is financed by these pharmaceuticals, nutraceuticals, you have your own reservations. Don't classify outrightly bad, but just see. So then suppose the findings of these will improve the well-being of my patients. Yes, see that. And a stop or negativity to any of the questions should stop the clinician spending further time, you know, initially only. So these are some of the things you will do. I already said about intent. Any of the articles will be trying to answer 4 things, therapy, diagnosis, etiology, and prognosis. Trying to find out the cause of the disease or best treatment or the prognosis, how long the patient will live or trying to cause. So just to find out, you know, what is the study trying to find out the prognosis, etiology or something, or the therapy. Then you'll have some fair idea why the study has been done, right? Then the intent is determined by reading abstract and if necessary, skimming the introduction. I said in last paragraph, I already said that. Last paragraph necessarily will tell why the article has been, why the study has been done. Then this is validity based on the intent, see the applicability. 4 clinical categories, which I already said. And there are, you know, many tools are available to critically appraise therapy related article, diagnosis related article, prognosis related, the charts are there or the templates are there, we can use them, and beautiful templates are there, you know, in the net. So the fast track appraisal in nutshell, you get started, they read the abstract has to be read, there is no shortcut for that. The whole face heading are to be surveyed, and tables graph, you can have a bird look and first sentence of each paragraph, if you skim through and you will grasp, you'll come to know. No? I already said it will come by experience. And methodology adopted has to be reviewed with a background of the intent. So again, the same thing. These are some simple questions about these randomization, sampling, masking, selection, etc. So the final word is, yeah, exactly, I'm well in time. With some practice, the use of worksheets, one can quickly, within minutes, perform the critical appraisal. This is the first-hand experience. You know, we used to think, you know, such a Herculean task. Go on doing it. And it's always advantageous to realize that few of the articles will be perfect. This year, you always keep in the back. So I think this is the last slide. Of course, there are my references. And thank you very much. And very sorry for rushing through all the information monotonously, rather, without any break. That we don't have any alternative for that. Now we have exactly half an hour from now on to make it the compensate for the non-interruption. So I have already 10 people who have read the article. Okay. Now we'll start the exercise. First, I'll ask voluntarily answer. Yes. Now we'll go to the title of the article first, you know. Can anybody volunteer to come forward to comment on the title quickly? One minute for everything. Otherwise, I'll take the name. The person has to answer that.
Sir, you want us to share the article, sir?
Yeah, I'll share that. Okay. I'll stay now. It's here. Yeah, can anybody please come forward to comment on the article? Yeah, article, title of the article.
Dr. Sudha has read it partly, so I hope that she has read the title. She can comment on the title. Dr. Sudha, AB22.
Malakni.
Yes, sir.
Share the article. No, it's not coming here. In my...
Okay, sir. Give me a minute, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, yes. You make it full screen, no? Yes, Dr. Sudha. She's here.
She had responded. Can't unmute. Okay, one minute. Participants. Sudha.
Sudha is from which institute?
I don't know, sir. Sudha, you can unmute.
Dr. Sudha, you identify about you and...
Yeah, you can. She's unmuted. You can speak now.
Yes.
I think, sir.
Are you trying to? Yeah. Sorry.
Give me, sir. I'll allow participants to unmute themselves. Now it is better. I put off that option because there was some disturbance. Okay.
Yeah, please.
Can I say something?
Yeah, please, please. Yeah, yeah. And who is this?
This is Doctor, madam.
No, it's Sudha. No, Doctor Sudha was supposed to speak. No, 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 one second.
It is not Sudha.
Sudha.
Sudha is not speaking.
Okay.
She's unmuted.
Okay, well, Manju has read the article. Can you comment, Dr. Madhu, Manju? Evidence?
Yes, sir.
Please comment on the article quickly. You have to run it. We're running out of time.
Yes, I'll run in 2 minutes. Sir, I went through the article. It's by Connor, sir. So I'm not a person to critique on it because he's my one of my mentors while I was doing by MD. Anyhow, sir.
Good point you raised. These things, when you are doing a critical appraisal, do not creep into your appraisal process. He was my teacher. Yes. He was like this, like that. You have a clean mind.
Okay,
do that.
Sir.
Don't bring that issue. Yes.
Okay.
Tell me.
So the starting from the title evidence of the presence of SARS-CoV-2 virus in atmospheric air and surfaces of a dedicated COVID hospital. It gives the idea after reading the whole article. He has.
No, madam. You comment about the title.
Title is. Okay,
are you happy? Is okay.
Not full. He could have
anybody. Used... Yeah, you tell me then.
Sir, all you say, both objectives.
Can you justify the characteristics of an article?
It is actually reliable. The research question or the research topic on which this the study is done, it is very relevant. First of all. Because it is according to it is the need of the hour and a novel thing also they are trying to find out not only the presence of SARS-CoV-2 in atmospheric air and surfaces but he is also they are trying to
madam one thing Manju I need to stop to you we are going in a systematic way section wise I am not asking you the whole this one others also other 10 people have to speak you comment about the title that's all
title
do you have any means of defining the article title, Dr. Vidyavati? Can you suppose you were to be here, how would you have titled it? You have gone through the article. Title should be reflect the primary objective of the article. Title should be crisp, brisk. So, if you apply those things, what do you think? Does it give you any indication of the type of the study? Nothing.
Awesome. Sir, can I answer?
Madam, please.
If I were to look, I will leave the words evidence of the presence. I would just link to presence of SARS-CoV virus in the atmospheric air and surfaces in a dedicated COVID hospital. I would have made it much more simpler because any study is looking for evidence. So this evidence is a redundant thing. That is what I would have done, sir, in
this study. So, I agree with you. You know, a little more what I would have made is to reverse one was to study. A study to provide something like that also can be prefixed. You know, study to provide evidence like that. You know, you can see. And what you said is take out the evidence. Yeah.
Can you speak?
Who is this? Yeah, please.
Pushpa, madam.
Study design should be mentioned in the title. It is not mentioned here. Whether they have studied this in vitro, in vivo, nothing is there. So that would have been a better title.
So you look for that and we'll skip the author, other things, etc. You know, author's credibilities, etc. They along the research unit, prestigious hospital institution, they are there. Coming to the abstract, can anybody give me overall appraisal of the abstract? What kind of abstract it is?
Unstructured.
Unstructured, very good, yes. Does it give you a whole big picture of the article? What all is there in that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, done. So as regards abstract, no, it's fine. There is no problem. Now come to the introduction. Come to the introduction. Can anybody comment on the introduction that is given here?
Yes, Mahalakshmi, somebody else has read, no? Others?
Yes, sir. One Dr. Gomati has read the article.
Yes. Any comment on the introduction? Yes.
Dr. Kalsad.
Kalsad, sir.
Yeah, yeah, please. Yes, Dr. Kalsad, very nice.
Actually, everybody can unmute themselves and speak. I have removed that option. I don't know.
Sir, in introduction, they have come out with the gaps in the literature review, sir. They are telling that there is difference in opinions in various studies that were done regarding the distance to which this, what is this, the virus spreads. Is it within 1 meter or more than 1 meter? So there is gaps in that knowledge. So to fill the gap, they have planned this study, sir.
So need for the study is justified.
Justified. Need for the study is justified.
Yeah, what are the negative points in the introduction, you see? What are the things? Are there any unwanted information is given which is not relevant to the study?
Hello?
Yeah, please.
Sir, this is Gomadi. And I feel that the review of literature is too little on the introduction section because the need, they didn't state very much.
Yes.
They mentioned the reviews articles, but the need is really less when we think about the situation.
Okay, so they have tried to arrive at a need. One thing what I noticed here is, see the number of references they have quoted in the introduction section itself, there are
39.
That is 39 references. How can that be? Not even 39 lines are there, those many references they have put there, number one. And introduction should have necessarily 3 to 5 references, pilot article, something, 1 or 2 references for what is not known, some will point to what is not known. That kind of a thing has to be there. And according to me, some unwanted information, like, you know, angiotensin, converting enzyme, receptor, cytokine, all these things are, I'm not telling wrong, they're wrong in the place here in the introduction. Those things are not needed. Here your issue is what? How the disease gets spread. So tell about the different
methods. About transmission. About transmission, it's not in detail, sir. More on treatment and other pathophysiology is given in the
introduction.
So those things should not have been there in introduction. Okay.
And,
so on that issue, please.
Index case, why it was necessary to tell about index case and all. That was not
So that's why I used one general word, unwanted information is there and the irrelevant number of references are there. Fine, but very good. Now we'll straightway coming to the, we'll omit the study side, we'll come to the study design. I want a very good comments on this. Study design, it all of you had various types of studies yesterday and the day before. You tell me, comment on this study design.
So it is written, type of study is written in vitro study, that's all. They have not come out with, maybe it is in vitro, but they, I think they should add the words like it is a cross-sectional or...
There are independent in vitro studies are conducted. That's what the question I was discussing with Arun also. Okay. That these studies are done in cases where you are not using directly human participants. You are using, it is more used in cell culture and all those areas. So those are called in vitro studies. Those are independent.
From the patients only the samples are collected now.
But patients, they have not collected from patients.
They are asked to cough and filter. That is how the methodology is given, madam.
Just to identify whether they are active cases, they have used the patients.
Only for that they have used patient. But actually, they have collected the sample. They have not collected actually from patients. This thing, they are collected viruses from the air. So
samples
it is in vitro and
from
they have
samples around. There is too much involvement in that.
There is.
Yes.
Okay.
So if that is
please.
So if we have certain reservations about the commenting on the study design, under the title of the study design, it is written that it is an in vitro study. No doubt they are not told why it's in vitro. Fine. Here it is a very tricky study in the sense no patient intervention is there. Even though they are taking sample to identify that the person is positive and all, that has nothing to do with the relevant here. In the sense, the samples are being taken only from the surface and from the air. So it's and can we think that it is an observational study? You are not doing anything. So the COVID patients are there, presented to you, and you are taking the samples and you are trying to find out how it is spread.
In fact, I went through this thing, whether it is a case control study. For example, when we study case control studies, there we want to see association between various risk factors and outcomes like that. But here, then I went specifically for searching in vitro study. Then they said that this is a type of study where it is used only for cell culture and all. So that's what is there. But if at all we put it into observational.
Sir, I can add it, sir. This is Dr. Ravi.
Yeah, please. Please.
So any underlying mechanism, if you want to study it in the cell culture, that is in vitro, can be, we can say that it is an in vitro, sir. Otherwise, this one, as you said, it can call it as an observation with cross-sectional, sir. At the time point, we are observing what is happening. It is anyway, it's a human sample only, actually, which is floating on the air. That's, we are going to observe it, actually. So it is an observational cross-sectional studies, we can add it up, sir.
Observational, I agree, sir, but cross-sectional, I wouldn't agree because we are not studying all the patients. No, so they have taken one sample of patients and only that area. At this point of time, they are not doing a cross-section of one ward or one area of the hospital. No, so they have taken around six patients. And then they have studied all those things, parameters, how much distance this virus has grown and things like that. So it is observational study. It is a form of descriptive study. But beyond that, calling it as cross-sectional study, I have a little bit this thing. You can say because it has performed outside, you can say that it is an in vitro study also. In vitro, in vivo is not actually a study design. No? So it's only a technique where you have done that.
Yes.
Basically, cross-section means at some point you study. Yeah. Actually, you are not doing a prolonged study in the sense. You are not so basically it is a cross-section observations, both are correct because at that point you are seeing how many had virus, how many did not have virus. So it's a cross-section observation study, that way everything is fine.
Sir,
we are not studying risk factor also, like how it is transmitted depending upon the distance, 1 meter, 2 meters.
Risk factor is not included. They are only studying the virus is there, what distance, and analyzing.
So whether risk is involved in 1 meter more load and
that is not their study at all.
Sir, there is a message in the chat box from Arun Daniel. It can be called ecological in vitro study under the broad descriptive observational study.
Ecological in vitro study. Ecological study. I don't know how to see that. So this broader descriptive observational study, what I noted here is it is a observational and descriptive study. Say, and this ecological. Fine. Now we'll go to the next. Yeah, about ethical approval, you know, the participants, it is not no kind of any intervention for the participants. Of course, they have taken the consent, fine, that's okay. And coming to the material and methods, any comments, please?
Sir, this is Rakesh, sir. And
yeah, please.
Respect to the size, sample size, as Mahalakshmi ma'am said, 6 cases, participants, but there is some confusion. They say 6 patients per day. Multiplied by 3, that could be accounted for 36. Did they do on the same patient or did they take the new? They have not explicitly mentioned. That is the first concern. And the second is they have said they have collected the swab sample from the material, the surface. Is it immediately after coughing, or what is that time gap between that? And did they maintain the same time gap across the samples?
They have mentioned
15 patients,
48 hours prior who came positive, something like that.
And moderate cases have been included.
Yeah. So these are some of the flaws. You can say they bring the heterogeneity, and the spread obviously depends upon the severity, how much of this virus the particular person is throwing in the atmosphere or on the surface. Those things are there. And one thing here in the material methods is, whatever they have used, you should have had a supportive evidence for that. You know, they have, while taking the air samples, they have said airflow of 1.5, 27 liters per minute and all. They should have had a proper references for that. This is what I noticed. Whatever methodology you are using, you should have a references. And the air sample was placed on the table cover, height of the patient's bed. Some things, you know, you have to have a references.
So can I add to Dr. Rakesh?
Yeah, please. Arun.
This is not the right word to use, because they are not using humans. They are not using any humans here. The six patients, what they are using is to collect the environmental samples. And if they are using cough and within a stipulated time they are going to collect the samples, then they are going to test only if there is an effect of atmospheric pollution after the cough. Here their motive is, aim is not to do that. They want to see if there is a regular presence of atmospheric viral infection. And I don't think they have to make some time span between that. So, atmospheric air collection compared with the near surface.
Yeah, Arun, what you said exactly right. The sample size has no relevance to the study. Tell you the in a broader way. Okay. And however you are here, you tell me what is that ecological mean? You said ecological means what?
Ecological. Usually we make environmental correlations, sir. Some disease happens in America and some disease happens in India. Mm. At the same time, we try to make some association between that. That is ecological studies. Events will happen in different places, but in the same time. So
but the ecological,
try to make a correlation between those two.
When you say ecological, we look at the community-based studies. This is actually looking at the virus traveling, how much distance.
Yes,
that is. So it is not basically an ecological study. They are just looking at how much of a virus presents, what is the distance they are traveling, like that. So when you say ecological,
subtypes, they have type in studies, sir, actually.
That is true. But when you are not doing a community study, the ecological part probably does not come into the picture.
So here the patients are coughing, and the specific time frame is also mentioned, 15 minutes. And that is put on a petri dish and within 1 feet from his mouth for 15 minutes. This has been specified, sir. So patient's action is included here. How can we just tell it is an ecological study?
Also, I have a question, Dean, sir. Suppose, no, you said sample size discussion. It may not be relevant in this kind of study. Suppose they have taken from one patient only, or they have done a few measurements only, and then they want to come to a conclusion that it stays only airborne, it is there for 2 days, 3 days. Then it will be totally irrelevant. No? So still we need to look at sufficient number of things to make that it is generalizable towards all situations, no, sir, or at least in that hospital.
No, this sample size, etc., will be of relevance when you say an intervention and you are trying to find out an outcome effect of that. That kind of a thing doesn't exist here. Even though
suppose they have done only one case, one measurement they have taken, and then they say that COVID does not remain in fomite surface, it remains only in the air, and they come to a conclusion. How can we validate that conclusion, sir? It has to be at least a section of the study population to say that. I don't know what is the word to be used, but it is you need sufficient number of observations to make a claim that this has got meaning or not.
Multiple exercises they wanted to do. That's why they have selected. So
I'm actually here that ma'am, hypothesis.
Okay.
I don't think try to prove or test some hypothesis here. So I think they're trying to find out if there is atmospheric presence of COVID virus when patients are there in a particular. They don't need a particular amount of patient or particular load. That and all comes next, madam.
Okay.
Ma'am, one more thing, ma'am. I have a doubt here. That is like when they do about study site, they told that atmospheric seasons they have mentioned, like four different seasons they have mentioned, but they have done it in one particular season. Does it also have the influence it can also have, which they have not justified?
They're all limitations. Limitations of the study. Even, you know, they have said the concentration of the patients in a square meter area of the ICU and a ward. At all, those are all some of the limitations they mentioned. I think we'll go now next to the discussion part, you know, which is very, very important. And one thing is, they also must have, while writing, they also must have, because so many, how many authors are there? Half a dozen authors are there, not half a dozen, more than that. 15 authors are there. And they also must have thought, what is the study design? Then finally left it like that, what we are arguing. This is what I think we have done. And coming to the
discussion. One more discussion, thing, sir. So this is.
Yeah, please.
They use a filter, sir, actually. The filter size is around 100 nanometer. But the virus sizes ranges from starting from 20 nanometer to, depending upon that, it will keep on increasing. So they are able to detect only the virus which is above 100 nanometer only. So which is less than that, which is start replicating or which start growing, so they can't able to catch those things actually. They missed out actually. So even though they know the size, they can choose a filter in an exact way, like a 10 nanometer filter also is available there. So these are the...
You're right, Ravi. That's why I said, in the material methodology, what all they are using, they should have given a reference, proper references for that justification. That was lacking. Now, coming to the discussion, anybody can tell a couple of appraisal points from the discussion, how it is? Is it okay? Is it having any deficiencies? One thing is the results and discussion, both they have combined. You don't have any comment on that. It is okay. Sometimes we see some articles like that. Observations and results will be normally joined together and discussion will be separate. But anyway, results and discussions, they have did that. What is prominently absent here in the discussion? Even though they have references, except the one study, all 39 out of 39, only one is of 2006, remaining all are 19, 20, 21, these 3 years only, more of 21. And there is a problem, they have trying to portray that nobody has done a study of this kind. Others, the workers, the results, they have not compared with them and all. And I specifically with this point, if you go through the references list, there are about a couple of studies which are of the same primary objective as them. They should have discussed their findings, you know, reference number 25, 26, 27, 28. These are all something related to that. And they could have compared in the discussion part findings of those studies, which are quite relevant, appropriate, and related. That is totally absent in the discussion. Only they were just simplified. No comparison, no contrast. Yes? Somebody can tell me something.
So they have come out with the limitations of their study, sir.
Yes, that is there.
Which is very good thing because the others can continue the similar type of studies with new objectives. So that is one strength of this study, that of this paper, sir. They have come out with their limitations.
Yes. And one more thing I remember now. What was the rationale of having patients something 18 years or something they have written?
Above 18.
Above 18, sir. Above 18. I try to find out the reason. It's okay, no problem.
So in the discussion section, that is done, and limitations they have clearly spelled out. And over there, the one good interesting
that's
thing
because pediatric age people will swallow, sir. They won't cough out. They swallow.
They also cough out, Usha. Come on. Okay.
Not anyway, much. There'll be more swallowing only.
Yeah.
And another thing I want.
And one thing, interesting thing is. Yeah.
Table number 2. Is it really necessary to push old thing on this?
Yeah.
Instead of that, they would have just analyzed it and they would have. So it is just to extend the length of the article. 10 pages article.
See, not only 4, madam. Table 2 also is like that.
That's what I'm telling. Table 2
everything
also
is.
That shows the article was published by the journal in a hurry. Editor didn't have time to do that all peer review process. So as and when, you know, COVID time, everything is right, get it published. So many things got published. Then the one thing, very important thing they have pointed out is that the strength is whether the, what is that, RNA is from the living or dead or something like that they have commented here. No? Is RNA detected are from live virus or from the dead ones? They have not been able to, that they have clearly spelled out. That means somebody must have gone there and some COVID positive patient left something. That's it. Now coming to the conclusions, are the conclusions commensurate with the objective? So the conclusions are not very pointed out, you know. So it is for environmental air surfaces of the hospital and eating patients are contained with SARS virus, indicating potential airborne and surface transmission of SARS. That's it. Correct. One line conclusion.
So that particular distance they have taken 1 meter, 3 meter. About that, they have not concluded anything.
Of course, that was not there.
No, they have not mentioned anything about that. Their aim was whether it is airborne, that is one thing. Another thing they wanted to know from 1 meter and 3 meter, why they have collected them.
Yes, you're right. So
that distance matters.
We come to the last part now. Can anybody comment a little boldly on the references? Because some of the issues we already addressed halfway through. Total number of references are 39. That is one of the important parameters when you are doing the critical appraisal. I already made one comment that, you know, the increased number of references doesn't increase the validity. Okay. And I also commented that in the introduction section itself with 39 references. 2 to 39, something like that for one sentence. Those kind of things are there. And some of the references are which are quoted here have no relevance. That's why, you know, probably many of you might be knowing. Annotated bibliography is many a times required. What points you have taken particularly from that article which you have quoted has to be there. You know? So the, I will say, overuse or inadvertent use of the references. That's one comment, certainly no doubt I can make that way. Any other thing? Chalo, Dr. Vidyavati, if there are nothing, we'll conclude the session.
Yes, sir, the references, the references they have quoted is whatever studies have been done for the past 1.5 years about COVID, they have quoted it here, sir. But what is relevant to this topic, this journal article is very little.
Yeah, that's why I said, no, you use the word annotated bibliography. If you make that, so if any of the journals ask for the authors, you identify 3 annotated bibliography out of this big garbage. That's what they say. So then you really think of, they are just quoted, isn't it? one statement in the introduction you must have seen, 28 to 30, one statement.
30.
As of now, general notion is that virus gets transmitted either through droplet or through direct contact with infected persons. References from 22 to 30. Okay. So these kind of things. Anyway, it was a good exercise. We try to give some messages, because they have some postgraduates are there. You would have had some hint as what has to be done in the thank you very much.
What was enjoyable about that experience now, sir, is that so many people came and actually they dissected the article like that. I used to think why they are calling it as independent peer review. So I thought you should not be influenced by anything. That's why I thought it was called independent peer review. If they put one committee and then give the paper to them, no article will ever get published
in journals.
I think that is what was very nice about the session.